So would you pray with me and for me? Oh God, may the words of my mouth and the thoughts of every heart in this moment be pleasing to you. God, you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. In his book, The Gospel Goes to Broadway, author James McCormick says this: Broadway musicals are a powerful way to touch audiences down to their very souls. It's an interesting statement, especially if you're not someone who necessarily thinks about Broadway musicals being anything more than a bunch of people singing and dancing. But if you've paid attention, if you've been to Broadway musicals, you know that oftentimes Broadway musicals address some of life's deepest issues, life's deepest challenges, and seek to offer a word of hope to the audience. In fact, McCormick says the music of Broadway often intersects with the life of faith. And I love that that's what Daring Ministries has been doing for the last several years. Every summer for the last several years, Daring Ministries has taken a musical on the road at the beginning of the summer to take that great music of Broadway and a message of hope, the good news of the gospel, to all kinds of people. They've done that year after year, I will say, with the exception of the summer of 2020, because nobody went anywhere in the summer of 2020. But they've done this every year, and this year they're doing something a little bit different. They're taking music from several different musicals and presenting them in a review of sorts with selections from these different musicals. And I've been inspired by that, so much so that I felt like it would be good for us and fun for us to look at maybe a few of those musicals and the selections from those musicals and find the gospel in them. And so we're beginning this week with a DreamWorks musical, The Prince of Egypt. Now, I want to ask this crew over here, have any of you all ever seen The Prince of Egypt? No. Okay, you need to go home. You can watch it on Amazon. I want to tell you that, okay? I'm going to ask these guys over here, have any of y'all seen The Prince of Egypt? Okay, good. Okay. It was in the regular rotation in our family when my kids were smaller. So my kids know all the music. In fact, I watched it with my big kid one night this past week. What's interesting about this 1998 production that eventually went on to be on stage in London, the producers found a way to take one of the darkest stories in Scripture, a story about murder, not just once but twice, murder and slavery and oppression and deprivation and anger. They take this dark story and they offer this message that there can be incredible hope even in the midst of great suffering. So both the film and the stage production tell the story that we find in Exodus, beginning with the murder of the Hebrew children, Moses' adoption by the daughter of Pharaoh, his ultimate reckoning with his own identity, his flight from Egypt, his encounter with the burning bush, his return to Egypt to confront the Pharaoh, his brother, his observation of all of the plagues, including the final plague, which brings death to every Egyptian family. And then ultimately, the Hebrews fleeing through the Red Sea ahead of Pharaoh's armies. We have a story that we're going to read from the book of Exodus today. Jean Gurley is going to come in just a second and read that. Let me give you the context. This reading comes after the final plague. Because Pharaoh's family has been affected, Pharaoh's firstborn son dies. That's what causes the Pharaoh to say, okay, just go. Moses gives very specific instructions to the Hebrew people about how they're to get ready to go, and that's where we're going to pick up our story. So Jean is going to come and read that to us this morning.
Chapter of Exodus, verses 17 through 22. Will you please stand in body or spirit as you are able? When Pharaoh let the people go, God did not lead them by the way of the land of the Philistines, although that was near, for God thought, if the people face war, they may change their minds and return to Egypt. So God led the people by the roundabout way of the wilderness toward the Red Sea. The Israelites went up out of the land of Egypt, prepared for battle. And Moses took with him the bones of Joseph, who had required a solemn oath of the Israelites, saying, God will surely take notice of you, and then you must carry my bones with you from here. They set out from Succoth and camped at Etham, on the edge of the wilderness. The Lord God went in front of them in a pillar of cloud by day to lead them along the way, and in a pillar of fire by night to give them light, so that they might travel by day and by night. Neither the pillar of cloud by day nor the pillar of fire by night left its place in front of the people. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. Thank you, Jean. So the Hebrew people really had no idea where they were supposed to go. But the good news for them is that God knew. And God knew what was ahead of them, and God knew that they needed to go the long way around rather than by the shortest way, because the shortest way would have taken them right into the path of the enemies of Egypt. So God sends them the long way around. They have no idea where they're headed, what's before them. They only know, the Hebrew people only know what's behind them, slavery and deprivation and suffering in Egypt. They have no idea what lies ahead of them, where they're supposed to go or how they're supposed to get there. But God knows where they're supposed to go, and God is going to show them the way to go through the pillar of cloud and pillar of fire. Pillar of cloud by day, it looked like a cloud by day, looked like a pillar of fire by night. And it goes before them to show them where they should go. And so they follow it, and whenever it stops, that's where they stop and make camp. And they don't break camp and move until the pillar of cloud, pillar of fire begins to move as well. And throughout their time in the wilderness, this manifestation of God's presence with them never leaves them, always going before them. Even when God gets very angry with the people, God's presence never leaves them. And this is good news for the Hebrew people. And it's good news that we've been given as well, because Jesus says it at the end of the Gospel of Matthew, I will be with you wherever you go. That's good news for us, because we live in a time of great uncertainty. We know there's an election happening in November, a lot of anxiety about that election. And no one really knows what will come about once that election is over. There's all kinds of opinions coming from all kinds of different directions about what could happen. And some of it's very pessimistic, no matter how it turns out. Some of it's very optimistic, but we don't know. It's uncertain. Those decisions that were made by General Conference last month for the whole of the United Methodist Church, they've created a lot of uncertainty for a lot of people, a lot of anxiety. What does this mean? What does this mean for the global church? What does this mean for the church in the United States? What does this mean for the church in North Texas? What does this mean for First United Methodist Church of Allen? There's a lot of uncertainty about that and a lot of different opinions about what will come because of that. There are some who say, this is the beginning of the end of the United Methodist Church. And there are some who are saying this is the beginning of something brand new, hopeful, new life, and healing. But nobody really knows. But God knows. And the good news for us is that God knows where we are going. And God goes before us. We don't have a pillar of cloud, a pillar of fire, but we do have the knowledge of Jesus Christ, and Christ promised to us that Christ will never leave us, and that God goes before us into the future. God is the one who holds the future. God is the one who makes a way where there seems to be no way, and that is good news for us, and I hope that gives you hope. In a time of uncertainty, because when is the future ever certain? So I am grateful that Daring Ministries recognize there's a lot of good songs of hope from The Prince of Egypt. By the way, if you don't know, it is an animated film, but it really is a good film. It's kind of a classic. A lot of good songs, some really hopeful songs, and I'm so appreciative that they chose Miriam's song. In the film, Miriam sings this song after the final plague, and Moses knows that every family in Egypt, except those who have the blood of the Passover lamb on their door, every family in Egypt has lost their firstborn to death, including the family of the Pharaoh. And the Pharaoh is his adopted brother. And he knows that Pharaoh has a beloved son. And so Moses goes to his adopted brother, the Pharaoh, sees his grief, is rejected by his brother, and told to leave and take his people with him. And Moses leaves in despair and devastation, dealing with his own grief. For the Egyptians had been his people. This was his family. He falls to the ground in devastation, questioning what he's done. And it's at that point that his sister Miriam comes to him and sings the song, When You Believe. It's a song full of hope. Daring is going to come and sing this. I want to tell you, there's one part of this where they're going to sing in Hebrew. And I want you to know what the Hebrew means. It comes from, y'all can come on up and get in place. It comes from the book of Exodus, the 14th chapter. It's from Moses' song after they've come through the Red Sea and Miriam's song at the same time. And here's what the Hebrew words mean. I will sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. Who is like you in the heavens, O Lord? Who is like you glorious in holiness? In your mercy, you lead the children you have redeemed in your love. You will lead the people you redeemed. I will sing, I will sing, I will sing.
soon.